Hare Krishna. What is a helpless condition in face of a certain problem? When in the material world, when we are faced with certain material needs, we feel helpless. A poor man, if he's seeking a job in any place, he has no money and he's quite frustrated with his state and wants money, then what does he do? He cries helplessly and then goes and begs to a person who is a higher above him. So that is the helpless condition. He goes to his friend who has a lot of wealth or who can help him, and exhibits his helplessness, and that is how he tries to seek help. So helpless, feeling helpless and then working on the solution is the normal way in the material world it goes on. But when it comes to devotion and devotional life, when one feels helpless, what does he do? He doesn't feel the need to go and ask for help to any person who has that wealth, who can help him in that spiritual times. Why is that? He feels helpless, but he does not ask why. Why does he not ask? In the material world, we see that the poor person who suffers a lot due to the lack of the whatever he's seeking, he immediately feels helpless and goes and asks. But in the spiritual world, why does one feel helpless and despite that not go and seek out a solution or a remedy to his situation? Why does that happen? So the first thing to understand is, when you feel helpless, you want to go to the person who you trust. Just not to any person, to the person who you trust. And who is that person who you trust? You know that you cannot cheat yourself there. So when you are helpless in the spirit, in the devotional matters, it takes a lot of time thinking where to go and express your helplessness. And this usually everybody does it only to the people they trust. So who are the people they should trust? Now, everywhere there is discussion going on and everyone knows, and they think that each one know, and they might know also as well. But it is individual, and when it comes to individual, we are the ones to take the responsibility and make a decision. So if you feel helpless in devotional matters, who will you go to? So that is very important. And of course, you would not go to just any other person. You would want to find a particular, you know, a solid remedy to your state. So you would definitely seek a person who you trust the most. And if you don't have anyone like this to trust, what will you do? You have to go alone. So, but this, one may feel that how come this is a situation, the person does not have any friend or any go-to person or any elderly person available to seek help. Why is this happening? So the solution to this, the solution not, but the answer to this is that he would want to, he's so distressed in with his situation and the repetitive nature of the problems that nothing calms him, and he doesn't find solace in anybody and or in anything. And why is that happening? Because he has been in despair with every situation that he's put in, and sometimes it may look like an overdoing, but this is not an overdoing. Only that person who is facing it knows the nature of the problem, and this is not a problem in it. In fact, it is a sure shot, stepping stone to a newer dimension. That is the way to look at it, and it is not even a way that is universal or in the material, in the world, that is universal, that people should generally resort to like this. This is his sole decision. He himself takes a decision and he is made to believe in that, and he can never go wrong in that. So are there such characters in the scriptures that one may come across? So Bhagavatam is the book where one would immediately run to find a reference of it, not a solution. There's never a solution in this material world. There are many problems. The problems come at every step, but there's never a solution. There is just pushing it to some other direction. And the same thing, even in the spiritual situation one will find himself in. There's no permanent solution to it, nor a solution. There is always a push to a different direction. So in Bhagavatam, where is such a character we find? The running through the chapters of the Bhagavatam, I just happened to come across one story about Kunti Maharani. Then there are many such people who are talked about in Bhagavatam, and we find a reference to the situations of their life, and we try to understand how they got through all that situation. First of all, why did they fall into that situation is another story. Once you fall into a particular situation, then how you are taken through that situation and then come to a particular halt is another story. So in Bhagavatam, it is said to be the Lord's Leela. But in our life, no such things we find. It is all the story of Pandavas and the Kauravas in Bhagavad Gita and even the first chapter of Bhagavatam. But in our life, we don't have, I'm not the son of any king. I'm not the daughter of any queen, something like that. And I am not a fighter, Kshatriya. I am not a Brahmin. What am I? And then how am I to understand what are my duties? And which direction to go? How am I supposed to be understanding? Now, they tell everybody, just read the books, 2 hours and chant. Is that sufficient? One should ask oneself. Because doing a thing over and over for a long period of time, and when it does not show any practical result, then one gets frustrated. And one must ask. He has every right to ask. Because till now he was following someone blindly. And that is why he is revolving in the 84 lakh species of life in this material world under an illusory bondage. So when now this time has come where everybody is talking about Bhagavatam and pure devotion, then when we are reading the books, why are not we experiencing any progress in the right direction? Why does it happen? Is there something wrong with us? Is there something wrong with the person who we asked questions? Or are we in a bad association or in a wrong association? What is the matter? So these are the things you must write down and be aware, stay alert. These things are not so simple to be ignoring, because it's a matter of your life and death. It is that serious. And if you just take it casually, then it may take a heavy toll on you. Lifetimes, birth and death in lower species of life. But then there are spiritual pastors everywhere. What are they doing? Why do we not get any perfect answer? Why is it that we are suffering so miserably? How are we supposed to trust that person or even the Supreme Personality of Godhead? What is his role in our life? What is he doing to us? If we do not get a proper answer to this, and if we do not get proper, in spite of following properly and, you know, following the basic things, the regulative principles, and not finding fault in others, all these things we are doing, still we are not getting the practical results. So what is the thing happening and going on? Then people say, and they say it just casually, that is the problem there. You don't question it seriously. When you ask someone, I am being facing like this, and any person you ask, So anyone who shows up as a lecture speaker and they give a very casual reply, they are not concerned, they are not so serious. It's a QA session, they'll just reply. You ask a question, they'll just reply. They are not serious at all with anything there. And that is the problem. When you ask somebody some question and he replies, then there must be some action, practical. But it doesn't happen. So how long this will go on? You're asking somebody, then you're not able to follow anything. Then why did you ask that person at all in the first place? It means that person cheated you. Is it something like that? Or the problem is with you? So we must ask these questions, and we have every right to ask such questions. And we must find out the truth to it. We are asking somebody, he is a bona fide person, but still it's not working for us. So who is wrong, he or you? So then what is spiritual master, one may ask, or who is a guru? And what is his role in the life of human beings? So such questions come, and we must find out answer to this someday. Otherwise, this revolving in 84 lakhs will never ever halt because of the very nature of the Lord's leelas. A little offense you do, you will be thrown in the lower species. You will be isolated. You will not get any help. You will keep yelling for help in some dark corner and no one will ever notice you. So why is this happening? And why are not everybody entitled to receive any sign of progress? Are only few supposed to be receiving the so-called growth? Then why should one go at all to such gurus, the such situations where no one cares for you and no one is even concerned what is the nature of the suffering there? Why should one at all approach the bona fide people? So this one may ask. So in Bhagavatam, running through the pages of Bhagavatam, I just came across the story of Kunti Maharani, how she is suffering all the troubles. But knowing that this material world is full of poison, why would one wait and drink poison to know if there is really poison in the material world? When somebody has suffered, he has suffered miserably. So looking at him, why don't we learn it? That they went through such hardships, we can altogether avoid it. There's no need to drink poison to understand whether it really gives death to the human body. That would be foolish. Then why are we made to suffer through these hellish things? Does the Supreme Personality of Godhead not understand? Why does he not understand? Why is he making us? How come his people are bona fide? So such questions must be answered, and there is a need that we ask such questions. Otherwise, why to believe in the Supreme Personality and follow the instructions laid down by his people? There's no point in following and reading the scriptures. One may say, one may argue, and it is right. There's nothing wrong in it. One must argue like this. One must question like this, but not in a challenging mood. But if you are baffled, you have every right to present yourself. But the best way is to write down in a book all these questions, answers, and go ahead. Otherwise, no one will ever come to you and ask you, are you suffering? May I help you? May I help you? I say, like this, there is a counter in any places when there are events. May I help you? But in this spiritual path, no one comes and asks you, may I help you? We read Bhagavatam stories, so many stories, that this one was helped, this one was benedict, he received benediction, this saint or sage happened to cross and he felt compassion. What about your situation? When we read in the book, it is okay. But when will you get such compassion? And why should we believe in that when it is not affecting in our lives? So these are the questions we must ask. And if there's no one, if the bona fide person is not answering such queries, then he doesn't have a why. What is the need to approach such a bona fide person? These are the questions one may ask, and we have every right to ask, and we must question it, because it is a matter of confusion for the souls. If there is any confusion, you cannot progress even an inch in the material world too. Then what to talk of spiritual world, when you are baffled with so many questions and so much harassment, which seems to take you completely down in the darkness of the Mayavad philosophy. We came here for because we got attracted because of Prabhupada in ISKCON. But here there is nothing close to pure devotion. There is only Mayavad philosophy that we are every time dragged into. The mind itself is destroyed completely. Rather than seeing any radical changes, we are subject to fear. Fear and fear of death. Why is that happening? In spite of being in a so-called devotee association, sadhu sangha, in spite of being in so-called sadhu sangha, doing all devotional activities, why is a person suffering like this in the name of pure devotion? And who is the proprietor here? Such questions must be asked, and you must altogether cut down this suffering. There's no need to go through whole suffering. Somebody is grabbing you and deliberately pulling you into certain things again and again and again, and you cannot counteract it. Then what is the use of a bona fide guru in the life? And why would one believe that there is something called as a bona fide guru? Because we see that his acts or his people, they are of no use to us in our life. Their very sight is frightening to us. Their association is killing all the goodness in us. Then what is the meaning of a bona fide person's representatives? Such questions people ask, and these are the questions of the general people. And one may think, that these people are foolish and they are deliberately, they don't have faith in the guru or something like that. Faith is in the guru is one thing, but tackling these things and patiently going through is another thing. So, and these things must hold. Otherwise, why do we need a bona fide guru in our life? When you have to go through the hellish things which you never ever went through in your life, in the presence of bona fide guru, finding the guru like Prabhupada, reading his books, you are suffering this kind of mundane Mayavad philosophy. And what to speak of further things? Then what is the need of having a person like Srila Prabhupada in your life, his books in your life? What good will it do? So are the people bluffing? Are they fooling the society? One may think like that. And it is high time you think about it. Because if you do not inquire properly, do not question properly, then it will take a heavy toll on your life in terms of janma mrityu, perpetual birth and death. When we are seeing in the human body, we are a witness to this. In spite of so much suffering, nothing seems to change in the life. Then what are we doing in the life? Why are we living at all? What good will it do in the future at all? And what is the bona fide guru's role in the life of a human being? So such questions are very grave and serious, and one must be always curious and anxious to know that when the bona fide guru's presence and sadhu sangha cannot give anything to a soul, then what to talk of the poor people who do not have any direction in life at all? They say you should have a lot of merits, lot of good karmas to get even a bona fide guru. But if we are following him, trying to follow him, then why are we suffering the hellish things which are never meant to be for us? Such things one must question and not get carried away by the glam sham, glamour quotient of the very things that come into in front of you. In the form of perfection. Perfection is a glamour quotient, isn't it? This system is very perfect. They never go wrong. They are always up to the mark. Their words never fail. Till now we have been hearing such things. But when it came to the real life situation of dealing with problems of birth and death, and that too after reading a bona fide guru's books. Why would one suffer and be made to go through such hellish acts and made to suffer the karmas? Karmas are never to be suffered. Once you understand what is the purpose of life, that is the most disgusting thing that could happen to a human being, even spite of he reading the books of acharyas in the guru parampara or a bona fide guru. That is the most bad thing that can happen to a soul. So I opened the book of Bhagavatam and I happened to go through it. So there is one character called as Kunti. She's a queen and she is addressed as Kunti Maharani. So she is going through all the distress and suffering, but she is going through all this sufferings because of the Lord's Leela. So she is getting the credit, but we are like a cat and dog. We are being dragged into the hellish species. We are not in the Leela. So what good will it do to us if we even continue to tolerate, endure and not hit back? What good will it do to us? So these are the questions to understand. When we read about them, they are serving the Lord in Leela. When it comes to our suffering, we are with the cats and dogs who are harassing just because they got a chance that somebody can be tampered to such an extent. So Kunti Maharani's prayers. So what good will it do when a person like this reads the Bhagavatam? There should be some difference in his life or not. But if we don't see any difference, then what is the credibility to the books of written by such a bona fide guru? One should ask a question to oneself. It's not a matter that we don't trust the books. But what is the use of writing such books when the souls have to suffer in spite of having the books with them? So when the Lord descends, what for he descends, how many people are benefited in his presence and how many get bereft or are deprived of the most good in the life? Such things occur to one and one is forced to think about all this. But this will become a karma in itself, because all people are around. You are in a situation where everybody around is in a competitive mood and they'll take advantage of your situation and do something and keep using you. So this is time to check if somebody is using you in that manner. If you are being used by someone in that manner, you will never ever come out of this hell. And the bona fide guru has nothing to do with such people, because he has already passed a remark for them. Nothing can be done with them. Nothing can happen of them. So this is also a truth. So what are we supposed to do? This is human life. Up to there is uncertainty. So better is not to complain and go on peacefully with whatever you have at hand, because finding the truth is another thing and dumping someone in certain corner, dark corner, and using him without giving him any spiritual benefit is another thing. So when we read about the Bhagavatam Leelas, we get carried away that this happened to this devotee. With me also it will happen. But for that you find out if you are a part of that Leela. And how will you find out? You need a bona fide guru for that. And if that guru is not interested in you, or he's superficially dealing with you for his own very selfish reasons, then you should detect this upfront and not become a prey to this situation. Hare Krishna.